equatorial belt is above. You can see that the belt girdling just above the, Jupiter's equator. To give you a sense of how big Jupiter is, 3 to 5 Earths could fit within the Great Red Spot.
He's grabbing all the gusto there.
You're being taken.
Damn, where did those come from? I hadn't seen one of those before, Mike.
It must be a diverse dynamic.
Hey, Joe.
Hey, it's Mark.
Had to get you on stage.
What's the thing growing off his shoulders?
People probably thought I didn't have to bring this time.
I was beginning to wonder.
Yeah, well, I just don't carry it around quite as much as I usually do, that's all.
Pointed at Walt.
Hey.
How you doing?
Fixing greetings. Look at that artwork. Well, I'll just videotape it and run to my dome. I'd never do that.
We have to tell Mike about the food.
God.
Wait, the good news is there's soda and beer on the bus and there's food at AVI.
Yes.
So,
thank
it took
you.
Me a while to get back. There wasn't anybody there.
There's food on the bus.
That makes all the difference, right?
I would look for that more.
I haven't brought my camcorder down.
Did you find it?
Oh, I have to bring it back down once.
Thank you.
Springmaster System has the software to address these problems.
The big stack.
Things are going well.
Let's go.
Spits.
Look at that.
Not my fault.
Yeah, okay. It's not all this isn't your fault, you're saying?
Not my fault. Blanket disclaimer, not my fault.
Okay, so what I need to do is probably get with Jeff Bowen and talk a little bit more about the ACAS.
Yeah, I need to know. Hi,
Ivan.
How you doing?
How you doing?
Praise Bob.
Praise Bob, yes. All praise Bob.
How many Bob images there?
Originator of the Bob religion, of the Church of the Seven Angels.
I did not know that.
And Bob is named after him. Bob Wilson.
Now I know.
Yeah.
Where did all this originate?
Well, Robert Anton Wilson's in San Francisco. And he is a science author and raconteur who wrote the Illuminati trilogy.
Well, now,
Illuminati conspiracy.
Now it makes sense.
Uh-huh.
It all works out.
Yeah.
Thank you for the information.
You're very welcome. Yeah.
Oh, that is interesting.
See who's hauling here.
And what we can do is we can change the what happens in what we drink, what happens the transition, the effect. We actually got this 7-level exactly.
How about rotation and translation? Like, can you put, like, let's say you want to build a solar system. Can you have, like, one planet rotating and have another planet rotating that? And we can do that.
AVI, audiovisual imaginary. Oh, we're excited now. Oh yes, it's a wonderful smell.
What planetarium does it have?
No idea.
Large group, so you want to go to the planet. You can go through this way. Go through here, go through the lab.
A new projector.
Okay.
As you can see, this is very basic right here. This is just some of the machining.
Are we getting free samples?
At one time.
Primarily designed as a
planetarium tool to add to effects that are normally not so vibrant. And so it brings color and movement and brightness to the dome, which haven't been there. This design here is currently at the Hayden Planetarium in New York City at the Museum of Natural History. And it's a clone to this one. And it's running in a show called Update the Universe. So if you happen to get up there, you'll see this in action. So some of these images that you'll see are part of that show, and others were created for this demo. So without further ado, I'll get going because it's kind of boring.
A videotape. All our shows are encoded onto videotapes. We have an encode-decode system, and this is our latest one that we have here, and it's actually decoding one of our shows that we have at the Planetarium.
Looks like Pink Floyd.
Yep.
This, <other radio guys. laughs>
this will take video or RDF, CD-ROM, Laserdisc. It takes a number of different formats, and we can store information onto tape or disc and play it back. And this is actually becoming part of our projector in the sense that we're taking the information from this and running it through a serial line to the projector. So all images, color mods, effects, offsets, everything is controlled serially. And it's a pretty amazing feat. And that's all encoded on the tape.
Got it.
And you can actually, with the new system we're working on, go in and change any parameters you want. So it's a very flexible system. So if you want to take a peek at it or ask any questions, feel free.
Right. I don't think you have time to ask any questions.
No questions.
Thank you.
We do all the design work and layout work, and then we have a board house do the actual PC boards.
And Bob Dobbs on the wall.
Yes, Bob. Come on in. You're welcome to come in and see where Jeff works. Come on in.
Now it's happening now.
Are these your usual hours?
More intellectual and some shows.
Jeff? Yes.
All hours.
Oh. Look at that screensaver.
This is our corporate.
Oh, you're event. Saying you're doing that. Oh, that's your work. Oh, okay, I see.
Oh, that's my inspiration.
Yeah.
I get a lot of
sometimes you just want to videotape a screensaver and put it up there.
Right.
It's very helpful having that.
Oh,
there.
Yeah.
See something on there? I said, yeah, I can do something like that.
That's a big patch panel.
Yeah, that's the image synthesizer's patch bay.
Did she say this is corporate work only, or?
Mainly special projects, festivals, corporate events, amusement parks, stuff like that. Although I tend to float around between planetarium projects and special.
What percentage of the work is planetariums and what percentage is corporate?
That's a good question. In the amount of production involved, this is most of it, because we're just constantly cranking out shows.
Well, they have a lot more money. Yeah.
And, you know, it's a lot of deadlines on this end of things that you have to be really conscious of. Yes, we have Bob.
The tracks left over for sound, so we can run an entire show on a VHS tape like this.
When?
Oh, yeah, you're on.
So, Dennis, I think you're tired of tingling.
Voicemail.
That means you're tired of some kind of technique that you're not doing right. So what you need to do is, like, you need to buy Midsummer Century because that has 10 times the romance factor that Tingry does, and if I'm reading you right, sir, you need some new inspiration. I have a feeling that the woman's telling you that, so I'm here to help you, sir.
Oh.
So, go get Midsummer, and I want a full report in the morning.
Okay.
Sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Individual VC in your office or home or whatever is something that I can't help you with too much. Other than on a one-on-one basis, I can try and help you a little bit there. But you want to move?
Okay.
Okay. Everybody, time out.
No, there's no way to get out here because the chairs there either. So
you can go right. Text is the typical size text that you're going to be going to have up here. Some of my text will be a little bit smaller than this, but for the most part, if you can read this text right in computers, the internet started out as NSFNet back in the 60s. Actually, it started out as a military net, and then it was basically has been controlled by the National Science Foundation. It'll work. You can take an old Apple IIe with a modem on it, and you can connect to the internet. It'll be kind of poor as far as what you can do with it, but by God, you can connect to the internet, you can send email, things like that. Obviously, the better your system, the better your response rate is going to be. If you can get Ethernet so that you can direct link to a node on internet. Ethernet runs at an extremely high baud rate, and you will be able to get real-time images. You can get animations on your computer right now, for example, and a whole bunch of other neat things. Let's see. Okay, and finally, another thing that you can do is you can do a call-in with a SLIP or PPP connection. If you've got a choice, take the PPP connection. It's a better connection. And you can get all the software you need for that by using one of Fraser's Internet Tour Guidebooks. He's got a Mac Internet Tour Guidebook, and he also has a Windows Internet Tour Guidebook with software, and I'll show you that software here in a little bit. In fact, actually, I can show you the Windows version of that real fast. My arrow here. Pop that down. Here. And so what I've got here is the Chameleon software, which comes with Fraser's book. This is free. It has a Telnet icon. It has a FTP icon here, email, two other odds and ends on it that have various utility uses. So all you have to do is just double click on, say, the mail icon, and you get yourself a mail address in there. You can call up various providers of these services and get yourself an account. And Fraze's books, the reference to his books is in the handout, and I'll list it here at the end of the session. And he has not only the software comes free with the book, but also the book lists the phone numbers of all the places that you can, or many of the places you can call up to get that information from. So I'm over this thing, and there's a couple advantages to that. One, it's free. Two, you can send files back and forth. Three, it's a lot of fun. And it allows you to contact people in a conferencing sort of a way. Okay, wouldn't it be really cool if all of us here, I mean, this is a great meeting. These meetings are wonderful, but they only happen every 2 years. Wouldn't it be really neat if we could sit around a big round table and just chat, and do it all the time, just whenever you felt like it? You can. It means it's an educational institution. In the United States, it'll end with like an edu. Other countries will end with a specific statement, such as, for example, CH for Switzerland, or FN, I think, for Finland, and so things like that. So AZ for, was it, Australia? Pardon? ES for Spain. So anyway, you can see there'll be a series of letters here that give your address. This is just like a regular mail address. You've got your house address, you've got the city and the state and the zip code. Same sort of thing here. This is your house address, this is the city, and that's the state, essentially, for your email and address. Now, here's a couple addresses. I told you I was going to give you Rob Landis's address. You can now flood him with mail. And so his address would be Landis at stsci.edu for Space Telescope Science Institute, okay, and then edu, so he's obviously connected as a university, and not as, if he was military, it would be .mil, if he was government, GOV, and I'm surprised this one's not GOV. If you would like to talk to his boss, you can give Ray Villard, drop him a line, you say, hey Ray, why weren't you at the meeting? You can send it to Villard at the same address. Likewise, if you want to get some Hubble Space Telescope images, you can contact Janet Morsey there. Here's her address, Morsey, same thing, at every out of room. So anyway, you can. There's the name and then just the address.
You might mention for those people that are really green, dot is just a period.
Ah, yeah, it's, right, okay, thank you. When I say dot edu or dot edu, the dot is a period, it's just a regular character there. dibs.oit.unc.edu. Okay, now, that's one method of doing this. Another method is Usenet News. Usenet News requires that you're able to get a hold of a news reader. A news reader will connect you on the internet to this thing called Usenet News. In order to do that, try at your, when you get on the local computer that's on the internet, try naively typing news and just see what happens. Or help news, or if all else fails, contact your ever-lovely sysop and say, I'm going to run news, and they may not have it. If they don't have it, I have a solution for you. If they don't have it, then telnet to someone who does have it. So telnet to this address here, and this is again in the handout, nyx.cs.du.edu, and then you want it, when you telnet, it will want you to log on .tech for technical aspects of space, sci.physics, there's a sci.education, for education and science. There's actually in excess of 4,000 lists on Usenet News, 4,000 different discussion groups. Domel, that's these list servers, there's a command that you can send to the list server that will give you all the lists that exist. Make sure you've got plenty of hard drive space because the list is about 3,000 lists long. Really, really have something that's worth 15 screens of posting. Send it to that person directly. Now, the reason for that is it first of all slows the net down, say sci.astro.planetarium. You have to have an agreement by the Usenet community to have it. And so any bozo in the world can create an alt.this, alt.that, and get some pretty bizarre ones. And so you got to be a little careful of those things flooding you out. But you can make almost every newsreader, everyone that I'm aware of, I'm only aware of about three, you can make them such that they'll only list those news groups you're interested in. The danger of just saying delete all the new news groups so you can log on fast is a site that has exactly the same information on it as some other site. If there's a site that's, if you're located, say, like I am in Utah, and there's a site in Arizona that's got my information, I would download it from the Arizona site and not from the site that's located in New Jersey. And that's just simply to say, again, this is listed in your handout. And so I've got the site address there, and I've got a very, very brief synopsis of the hundreds of files that are located in that particular site. And so, for example, pubinfo.jpl.nasa.gov, we're going to explore, we're going to log on to one of those here in a minute. You know, that's the actual computer. And then it's in the directory, news, and then the file name is itamin for Ida Moon Color, so itamooncolor.gif. And GIF is just a way of storing files that are images. There's various other ways, it's in a variety of other systems, but one of the more common ones is GIF, and unfortunately it's not one of the ones with the highest of resolutions. Jeff?
I should point out that for those of us that are slaves to DOS, and we're used to hitting the backslash key to delineate our directories in Unix, you yes. have to hit the forward slash key.
Good point, Jeff, thanks. Now, do note that the directory structure here has the other slash, the forward slash, nasa.gov. I have this in your handout. Unfortunately, when I reconfigured a handout to try and reduce the number of pages so that the airplane wouldn't crash and put on this big mass of paper, when I put it into columns in 10-point font, it unfortunately changed some of the lines to put them all in the same line. And so there's a little bit of an error in the actual handout, but it should still be fairly clear. Okay, so I send in my command. This thing here is my own personal prompt on my VAX. So that's home. This is just my my VAX prompt at my home computer. And then here's the command in bold. So it says a variety of things, tells me what's going on I don't care about. Finally comes down and tells me that jpl.nasa.gov. And then a little greater than sign. So that's my prompt. At that point, I type log in. It'll ask me for my username. I type in anonymous. At that point, it comes in here and says, anonymous login, OK. Send ID as password. As he had mentioned earlier back here, if the system is full, the equivalent of a busy sign is, I'm sorry, system's full. And it just bumps you right out, and you're back to your own prompt. So I'm going to send my ID as my password. This does not actually appear, so I've got italics here. So I would type in jsol@cc.weaver.edu. You now, it says user logged in, max connect time, 90 minutes. So if you get really screwed up in the thing and you can't get out of it, just reboot your computer or whatever to 90 minutes. It's going to throw you out anyway. Okay, so it tells me what my current directory is. I come down here, I type the word hash. That's a personal thing I like to do. Hash will give you every, I think it's like 10,000 bytes of data. It'll put a little pound symbol on the screen. And if you get one pound symbol every 2 minutes, you know that the system's so busy you might as well come back and do it after dinner. So I'll just go ahead and bail out. Usually they'll come across fairly fast. So hash just gives me the opportunity to be able to see how fast the system is running. So I come down here, I type directory. It gives me a little hash down here. It says opening connection for ASCII transfer. It gives me a little hash. I get one hash because the directory is fairly short. And then I get my directory listing. So here's the directory. And then Unix ease. Then what you get here is on this first column, it tells you if it's D, it's a directory. If it's not a D, if it's a hash, it's a file. And so that'll tell you whether it's a directory or a file that you're looking at. And so we can see we've got two files here, and then a whole bunch of directories. Real quick, the directories are archive, educator, high res, imager, missions, news, readme. A good file to get the first time. Can't read that one on the screen up here. Software, something. Then software, universe. That's the universe in the classroom stuff. NASA's supply to the educators. And then what's new? What's new is an excellent file to pull down because that'll tell you all the neat things that are in there. And so I think that's probably what I did next year. That's not what I did. Let's pump up one. And so what I did here is I personally decided on this particular episode to change directory to news. So I did cd news, and it says change directory OK. And I did a directory again. Open connection, and so now it should go ahead and give me my listing. And so you can see these are all files, they don't have a D there. And so I've got all these files, many of them are non sequitur as far as the some obscure coding for the file name. And so there's all sorts of things, such important files as gorillas.pr, presumably some public or press release about gorillas. And here's some cool stuff down here. We've got Ida Moon ST GIF, Ida Moon CLR GIF,
Right, even high GIF, that's high res. And so there's information there. All of these files are described in that first directory. If I had gotten a file that said what's new, it'll tell me which each of these files are. And so it turns out I want to go ahead and get this Ida Moon stuff because that's kind of neat. And so I've got these brand new files that are located and put on down here for me. Let's see, is anything happening? We're going down more of the same directory. So, notice here we've got SL9 dump. There's an SL9 Hubble Space Telescope one. SL9 Impact Text tells you all about that stuff. All sorts of information about the Shoemaker-Levy 9 thing. Let's see, this is a wide field picture of some sort. Probably done this as a status report. So this is probably this 7th, so it'll be July 1st, 1994, wide field camera status report, tells you what they're doing, what their images are that they're taking. So you can find out all the stuff that Hubble's doing, various other missions. So I decided I wanted to get the Ida Moon things. So I'm going to do a directory, Ida Moon *.gif, because I wanted to get a view of those by themselves to see what all is there. So it gives me a directory, and it says that there's three files in this fashion. So I then will change to binary because they're a GIF file, not a text file. So I type BIN or binary, the full word, doesn't matter. And now I'm going to get those files. I'm going to do a multiple get. So I'm going to do an mget. That'll get all the files for me in one shot. So I'm going to do mget itemoon, and then I've got a wildcard.gif. And I get a hash here as it opens the transfer, several hashes, sends the files over. Finally, it says it's opening connection for transfers, and then various other information. Finally, it says transfer complete after each one. And so now I want to do a direct, I want to go up in a directory, so I go cd up, and that gives change directory is okay. Just for curiosity, so I could show you, is basically that was the reason why I did this. We can do a show directory, and it gives you the whole directory information. It says, is the current directory. So there's various commands in there that you can do to find out what's going on. I do another directory listing again. Gives me the directories I'd showed before. And so now I want to do a change directory to software. Does that. And so we can see all sorts of software in here. We've got bin hexing software for the Macintosh. We've got image software for the PC and the Macintosh. There's a GIFer thing here for GIF viewer, GIF view stuff. So if you don't have a GIF viewing software, all the software you need is available on the internet. You will need a file that will unstuff or unbin hex if you're on a Macintosh or unzip if you're on a PC, your files, and you can get that software also on here. Read the README files when you log in, and it'll tell you about what's available on a lot of these things here. So you can see that we got that stuff, so we can just do a real quick zoom through here. This is a whirlwind approach to a fast FTP session. For those of you who are really good with FTP, please don't go to sleep. Okay, yeah, we've got PK unzip right here, and the best one is a PK204GEXE. Do a binary download on that one. It's a self-unzipping file, and we'll give you all the PK unzip zip utilities and stuff, and you can get that one right there. Pardon? Okay. Oh yeah, it was another neat software, SkyGlobe36. .zip. SkyGlobe is one of these planetarium software things, so you can run that. Get back directory back there again. Basically, I was just playing on the machine, so I captured this on my screen so I could show you guys. Let's see, now I want to change directory to educator. Okay, I'm going to do a directory listing again. I got all these files, various things on comments, on index to the education and such here. Well, one thing you want to keep your eyes open for is the index thing, the listing. There's generally a file on that'll list the index of all the stuff in there. It's a good thing to download because there's usually descriptions as to what the file. So I can do help directory. It'll tell me about the directory command. Finally, I quit. It brings me, says goodbye, nice. And then finally, I'm back at home. I do a directory to see if I got my files, and there's my files right there. So let's take a quick look at a few of them. And now see. Okay, where did the files go is a question. When you do an FTP like that, the files go to the account that you have on the computer connected to the internet. They don't go directly to your PC unless your PC is directly connected to the internet. If your PC is directly connected to the internet, then you probably know enough about it to already know where they go. if you're not directly to the internet, it's a very own internet node, they have gone to your account where you have at the university or whatever, they go to that account. Now, where they go in that account, I would do a directory listing in your master directory and look for that file there. But it's going to appear somewhere in your directory. If you can't find it on your home account there, it could be your only option is to ask your system operator. Now, Roland 2, this particular software is C-Show. It's shareware from CompuServe. It's one of the more convenient GIF viewers. There are various other ones available. Make sure your GIF viewer will allow you to view embedded comments. Many of the files you'll see, there'll be an Ida Moon CLR.GIF, and then there'll often be an Ida Moon CLR.TXT for text. And that has all the information describing that file. Obviously, you want to get that. However, the new GIF viewers will embed that information in it. And so you want to make sure you can get it. And I'll show you an example of that. So I had taken and had highlighted the file in the directory for the Ida Moon CLR, which means color. So let's go ahead and hit enter. It gives me some options on how to view it. Hit the space bar, and we'll come in here eventually. Shoot my hard drive, fire it back up. There you have a color view of the moon of the asteroid Ida and its moon right there. And so this was loaded down from JPL. Actually, I lucked out. I happened to log on within hours of when this image was posted. Now I had this image with all the people in my department crowding around my computer to peer at it within an hour or two of it being loaded by JPL and released from the Hubble Space Telescope. And I took this image. You can take pictures of your computer monitor. Make sure your shutter time is longer than the sync time on your monitor. Take a picture of your monitor without having big bands in it. The other thing you can do is, if you're a bigger planetarium, you already have it probably. In my case, I didn't see buying it since they already bought it in the photography department, so I just go and let them do it. There's special little boxes that will make a slide for you from these images. I ran this image down to him. This was a Wednesday morning that I did it. I had my public shows Wednesday night. Wednesday night, the day that this was released, this was on my dome. And I challenge you to do that. Even with Federal Express, it's going to be next day.
I have the computer connected to my...
Yeah, if you can...
to my video projector so it goes right on the dome.
Yeah, I don't have the capability yet. So if you've got the capability to project your computer on it, you can have it on there faster than processing time for film.
If you're using ProCom Plus for Windows, you can see the GIFs as they download.
Yeah, that's kind of neat. We'll get to that mosaic. We'll do that too. Okay, so there's that particular image. It says here, display comments, yes, no. I can type yes, and it will tell me, this color picture is made from images taken by the imaging system of the Galileo spacecraft about 14 minutes before its closest approach, blah, 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 blah. All the information that you would want to know so that you can look intelligent. When you talk about this image, it's all right here. All you have to do is memorize it, spew it back out, pray for questions. Okay, now, just a couple of the other ones, for example. Let's take one of the other ones. I'm having a hard time reading this, Amy. My eyes just demonstrate this thing. I think I'll figure out which one it is. Let's just take a look at it. This is a high-resolution image. That's the moon of Ida. Ida's moon in a high-resolution shot. It's kind of getting off the edge there, and they missed it there a little bit. So this is a raw image. Many of the images that will come down are, in fact, raw images. Let's try another one. Let's see. There's Ida high-res. So there's a high-res view of the surface of Ida. Of asteroid Ida. And so lots of neat things. Mars Observer's last sight before it blew itself to bits. You can get that image. All sorts of other things are all available there back there.
One neat thing too is most of them are public domain.
If you can download it on the internet, unless it specifically says shareware or something in the software, almost always, and of course all the ones that you can download from JPL and from Hubble Space Telescope and stuff, are public domain. You can use them to your heart's desire.
Your
Okay, so here's an example of some of the stuff that I've gotten. Let's just pull one right here. This one is, let's see over on the viewer. Okay, this is something that I got from Jeff Chester. I got it from him by an email. The from here is NSEP, or INSAP, something like that. Anyway, EP is presumably Einstein Planetarium or something.
Something like that. We have mainframe.
He's the seventh user of that, so they've come up with a very clear usernames of number seven.
Cheryl's number is, Cheryl's address is NASPL002.
Some systems use dumb names. So hopefully somebody will actually use
some of
the
dumb names. Systems.
Yeah. Anyway, so he sent this to me July 1st, and I sent out a message on GoMail, or on this High Astro Planetarium, I guess it was, saying, hey, I'm doing a workshop. Anybody got any comments or anything you want to stick in on it? Jeff responded, so did Scott, and so I got some comments back from these things, and I got this from Jeff, for example. So all sort of nonsense here about how I got the file, which I generally don't care. It's fun to look through that for one or two times to see where the file bounces around its way to you. But after a time or two of looking at that, you quickly get bored with it. And so, what's over here? More nonsense as to where the file came from, etc. Recent changes. Within the last 2 weeks, these are new FTP sites that have appeared within the last 2 weeks of when this file was made. And there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, there are five different files added. These are all www, there's a World Wide Web, we'll talk about those later. Within the last 4 weeks, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and then a couple of changes there. So 8 new sites came up within the 4 weeks of this thing. The internet is changing so rapidly that one of the things you have to find out is how to find out. And the ability to move a file down. You can do directories, you can access certain areas, and that's it. Telnet actually logs you onto that computer as a full user on that computer within whatever limitations there are for that level of user. And so Telnet will actually connect you to it. So I can be in Hawaii, and I can Telnet to my computer in Utah, and I can have complete access as though I was sitting at my computer on my screen and looking as though I was sitting there at home. I can read my email messages, whatever I want. Telnet gives you a direct connection right into your machine live to whatever that part machine is. Telnet versus World Wide Web. World Wide Web is a hypertext viewer, and so Telnet is a way to just get onto a machine. World Wide Web is more complete than that. Telnet gets you to a single site. World Wide Web will log you on to thousands of computers all over the place without having to do any of the Telnet commands, any of the FTP commands. World Wide Web, in particular, Mosaic, is to internet as the Macintosh is to the IBM PC. If you don't like commands, and if you don't like fiddling with your computer, you buy a Macintosh. And so you can do it all without knowing any of the commands. Same sort of thing happens here. If you don't like FTP, if you don't like Telnet, get Mosaic. Then you ignore all that stuff, you just go through it like it's a HyperCard stack, and you can just pull through all sorts of stuff. You can get the animations real time, all sorts of neat things. We'll come back to Mosaic here in a minute. Now, World Wide Web is Mosaic. Mosaic is a way to access World Wide Web. We'll come back to those things in a minute. So Telnet will connect you onto another machine. You can Telnet to SpaceLink. Soon, you will be able to World Wide Web or Mosaic to SpaceLink also. But you can Telnet to SpaceLink, so you can log on as a regular full user of SpaceLink at NASA's SpaceLink system. Real quick, by the way, here, HiTelnet is a slightly improved version of Telnet that will give you access to library card catalogs worldwide and various other databases that you can that'll give you access to. Try at your command prompt for your home computer naively typing HiTelnet, HyTelnet, and see if it does anything. If it doesn't, then you don't have it. If you don't have it, then you can Telnet instead to one of these two computers, and they'll allow you to log in as HiTelnet or as library, and then you can do HiTelnet from there. Now, this is not in the handout, there. So if you want to play with high telnet, you need a telnet to access .usask.ca, and that would be in Canada, and that will give you access to this high telnet thing. You can search through card catalogs on computers around the world for various libraries and universities worldwide to try and find some book that you're looking for that's really obscure. That spacelink.msfc, Marshall Space Flight Center, .nasa.gov. And so I did a telnet to there, and I don't think this is in your handout. That then says, welcome, the blog, I get into things, says, welcome to NASA Space Link. It gives you all sorts of important information, like if you try to do something illegal with this, we're going to hang you by your toenails. And then you read all this stuff that threatens your life. Finally, it comes down to telling you how to log on. If this is your first time, your username is new user. And so you log in new user for your username. And then for your password, you also put in new user. It gives you various important messages that you can't live without. And then comes down and tells you how to log in. So it gives you all sorts of important messages. It tells you, it asks you how to set up the screen for your particular machine. It tells you how long to make a scroll, etc. It tells you all about what NASA Space Link is. Various things, goes through all this nonsense about NASA Space Link. Tells you all the commands. Finally, it allows you to start logging in. So it comes down here, please enter your username that you want to have for your username. I put in jsoul, and it says your new username will be jsoul. Are you happy with that? And so is this correct? Yes, it's correct. And so it goes through each of these things, tells you, asks you if it's correct every time. Now enter your desired password. And it puts your password right there on the screen for everybody in the world to see. I didn't put it in there, I deleted it. Ha ha ha. And so, you put your password in and ask you, is this your password really? And you say yes. And so it goes through all these things and wants to find out your address. It wants to find out all sorts of things. It wants to find out your mother's maiden name. It wants to find out your state. It wants to find out all sorts of stuff. Asks you things like, what subjects do you teach? Physics, astronomy, science, and society. Is this correct? Yes. Etc. It asks you what grade level you teach. If you don't teach anything, say none. Ask you what kind of computers you use, and sticks all that stuff in. It's all self-explanatory. So finally, after you get through all that stuff, it says this will take a few moments. It sets up your account, and then allows you into NASA Space Link at long last. So now it gives you this, the first option you have is how to log off the thing. Gives you that option. Then we have various things here, NASA Space Link overview. So you can just type in one of these things. There's space exploration before the shuttle, space exploration of the shuttle and beyond, all sorts of odds and ends that you can find out stuff. The NASA Foster program, for example. I chose item 9, which is unreadable. Can anybody read item 9?
Instructional materials.
Okay, so I wanted to find out what sort of instructional materials they have. So I do that, it gives me the instructional materials directory. I have a command to get to the previous directory, I can get to the main menu. I have the living in space activities. There's something about Earth. Mission Earthbound Teacher. Then it has all sorts of other subdirectories in here. I chose the subdirectory 1, which is to get me back to the other directory, if I recall correctly. And so I get back to my main directory here, so I can choose another one. I chose 3, which is Current NASA News. And so when you do that one, it gives you all the various current news available. It gives you news topics for shuttle, news topics for everything you can imagine. Finally, I chose 1 to get back to the main menu. It gives me my main menu back. I chose 8. 8 gives me NASA educational programs. So I look through that. It gives you a whole piles of NASA educational programs. There's images and stuff you can get to. I went back to the main menu again. Finally, do you want to exit the system? Yes, I want to exit the system. And so it bails you out of the system. It tells you how long you were connected. If you're doing, you can do this by a phone line and the modem too, but internet's cheaper because you don't have to pay for the connection. And then finally it brings you back. I end up back in my home property and back home. So the point of that whirlwind tour through NASA Space Link is that as you saw all those directories available there, it gives you an idea of the information that NASA has available for you.
You're supposed to stick your tongue out. There you go.
Hey, look at this guy.
Hello.
Who is this? What are you doing here? Get that out of my face.
No comment.
No.
Just a minute.
I'll let me...
Here, hit the camera.
I had to move you.
Right there. Oh, aggravated.
Oh, wait. You're being aggravated.
How you doing, Mark?
Like, oh, we're doing good. How are you?
If I did move.
my goodness. Okay. This is okay.
Behind the scenes.
I get a sense that this was a great conference.
In September, October, and a little bit into November to install an 870 movie projector. We will be using the linear loop technology. And in January, we will open up and we will have a 100% film program in the Planetarium Theater for at least 6 months. During that period of time, we're going to remake the Planetarium and we will put in all new shows. I attended a workshop this afternoon on formative evaluation. We are certainly going to be using that technique to do our presentations. We will phase back into Planetarium operation then show at a time. And we will put back in preschool programs and school programs, family shows, laser shows, maybe even feature shows. We think maybe the feature show and the film audience are the same ones, so we're not sure about that. Those are the plans for the Planetarium's future. My own plans for the future include retirement sometime next year. I will be 55 then. I will have been director of the Strassenberg Planetarium for 25 years, and I figured that's a good time to stop. I will also have been in the planetarium business for 34 years at that point. And it's interesting that I should be talking about this because it was just a few miles up the road at Stetson University in the land that I found my first planetarium and got started in the planetarium business. So there's kind of a nice circularity. Well, I did make up some notes about some things that I wanted to say tonight because over the years I have come across some principles. Some of them I can take claim for as being Hall's laws. Other things I think just have cosmic truth in them. And I want to share those with you tonight. The first one is what I call the law of least likely explanations. You're beginning to catch on to it already. Let's imagine that you have had a terrible headache for 3 days. It does not go away. Your mind immediately tells you that you have an inoperable brain tumor and it will be fatal. Now you have to admit that someplace in your mind that does go on. Well, you can see that this is the law of least likely explanations at work. I see a light in the sky and I don't know what that is. What is the least likely explanation for what that light might be? An extraterrestrial being piloting a craft in the Earth's atmosphere. Well, it turns out somebody else already thought of this. It's called Occam's Razor. Anybody know about Occam's Razor? Good. Here's what I found out.
Give the microphone over to Spain at this time.